Good morning, everybody. Happy Easter. We will be doing the call to worship soon, but just because we're all in the spirit of it, there's an ancient call and response for Easter morning that goes like this. Christ is risen, and you all say, Christ is risen indeed. Hallelujah. So let's do that twice. Christ is risen.
Christ is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
Christ is risen. Christ is risen indeed. Hallelujah. Welcome. Hallelujah indeed. It has been 3 years since we last did this. 3 years since we had our breakfast potluck together, since we gathered to celebrate the resurrection of Jesus Christ and had the egg hunt. And I know that because of that, the angels and God and the saints who have been part of Walnut United Methodist Church are gathered with us this morning with heightened celebration and gladness. And I want to welcome all of you back who have been members and haven't been back since the pandemic, or new people who have just come and found us by friends or word of mouth. Welcome here. So I do have a couple of announcements for you this morning before we move on with this celebration service this morning. First, we have bulletins, and if you've not gotten a bulletin, they're in the narthex, and you can just grab one on the table there or share them with a person next to you. And then secondly, there is an egg hunt for kids after the service. So make sure to stick around. And if you happen to come late this morning and you didn't get to have coffee and treats, that will all still be there for you after the service. So you can just treat yourself to that afterwards. Also, you'll note in the bulletin that there's a sheet of dedications for the lilies. And after the service is when you're welcome to grab them and take them home with you and plant them or put them on your table or do whatever you want to do with them. I'm going to offer a new class starting in May every Wednesday called Recognize the Sacred in Your Everyday. Some of you know that one of my passions and specialties is ancient contemplative methods. And this is a very special one to me, and it's going to be led through Zoom every Wednesday. And I lead you through an exercise that helps you recognize God and God's fingerprints in your life. Because we often don't recognize it because we're so busy with the to-do tasks and the default, all the obligations of our day. And so this will help you to slow down and get a sharper vision of God's presence in your life. All are welcome, no matter where you are on your faith journey. Also in May is our Faith in Film series. And this is the first one for many years, and I'm gonna let Jay talk about that for a moment.
Well, thank you, Pastor Lydia. And yes, Faith in Film is back. I'd like to thank the committee for your recommendations. And our beloved liturgist today, Don Driftmier, said, how about full count? And for those of you who know baseball, full count is a 3-2 count when the important payoff pitch comes. Well, this gentleman in this film has a important challenge in his life as well. And he is really going to be challenged in a lot of ways. I think you won't want to miss this film. It's Saturday night, May 28th, that's Memorial Day weekend. We're gonna do a potluck, show the film, and then have a great discussion after. So I hope you can all come, it'll be a great time. Thank you, Pastor.
And next, so you will see highlighted this morning the choir. And if you wanna join the choir, the rehearsals are just before the service and after the service. And if you'd like to sing, there are no tryouts. We would love to have you if you're looking for a group to sing with, and they're a lovely, beautiful, joyful community. So I encourage you to talk to one of the choir directors or even to me to learn more about how to join our choir. And finally, on our website, there's a way to subscribe to all of the events going on in our church, because there's just so much going on since we've opened again. And so I encourage you to go to our website, put in your email to get our online newsletters every week to stay in the know about our activities.
Good morning and welcome. Happy Easter. As Pastor noted, for those of us that are young in heart, the egg hunt is for the children. So. I'll see you out there. Beside that, if you've bent over, you probably can't stand back up. But anyway, have fun this afternoon and enjoy the day. It's going to be a beautiful celebration of Christ risen. Please stand if you can and join me in a call to worship. On the behind me. Hallelujah, Christ is risen.
The Lord is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
May his grace and peace be with you.
May you fill our hearts with joy.
Let us now join our voices in the opening prayer. Eternal giver of light and light, this holy morning shines with the radiance of the risen Christ. Renew your church with the Spirit given to us in baptism, that we may worship you in sincerity and truth, and shine as the light in the world, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Our opening hymn, the bulletin has a misprint. It is really number 302 in your traditional hymnal, Christ the Lord is risen indeed.
Easter baskets because you're ready for our Easter egg hunt after the service.
What do I have in my hand, everybody?
An Easter egg.
And what do you think is inside?
Candy.
Okay, ready?
I think that's candy.
Oh!
Nothing.
There's nothing! Where did it go?
Who
ate it? Did I eat it? I don't know. I didn't eat it.
A monster.
A monster ate it. You were expecting candy to be in here. One of the older kids knew there was nothing. He could see that there was nothing. But some of the kids, a lot of you, were expecting candy to be in there, and it's empty. Well. Yes, you're right. Candy would have fallen out, but there was none. Now, do you know why we celebrate Easter this morning? Go ahead. Who wants to say, why don't you go ahead first?
Because Jesus is risen.
Jesus is risen! Can you guys see this picture?
Yes.
Jesus died. He was put into a cave. Then his friends went to go see him in the cave, but it was empty, like this egg. They were expecting to see him, but he was not there. How would you feel if you were his friend and you went to go find him and the tomb, the cave was empty? Yes, go ahead, Yubin.
He was off to his father.
He was off to his father, yes. So, Jesus comes from God, and he died, and then he didn't die to show us that God's love for us and God's love for you never dies. Never dies. It is always alive. Now, this morning, what flowers do you see all around me?
Lilies.
Lilies. Easter lilies, Easter, the flower of Easter are lilies. And do you see on my row here? What is that?
A lily.
A lily. Now, do you know why the lilies are the flower of Easter? Yeah, go ahead.
Because lilies die at winter and come out at spring again.
That's right, because lilies die during the winter. But when spring comes again, do you know what comes sprouting out of the ground?
Lilies.
Lilies. And that is why the lily is a symbol of Easter, because they come back to life. Like Jesus, yes. Let us pray together, dear friends. Repeat after me. Dear God.
Dear God.
Thank you for Easter.
Thank you for Easter.
And let me know how powerful your love is.
And let me know how powerful your love is.
Amen.
Amen.
Thank you for joining me this morning, and now you're all off to Sunday school, and I'll see you after church for the egg hunt.
Chapter 24, verses 1 through 12, if you'd like to follow along. Got to unfold my glasses a moment. On the first day of the week, at early dawn, the women who had come with Jesus from Galilee came to the tomb. Taking the spices they had prepared, they found the stone rolled away from the tomb. But when they went in, they did not find the body. While they were perplexed about this, suddenly two men in dazzling clothes stood beside them. The women were terrified and bowed their faces to the ground. But the men said to them, "Why do you look for the living among the dead? He is not here, but has risen. Remember how he told you while he was still in Galilee that the Son of Man must be handed over to sinners and be crucified, and on the third day rise again." Then they remembered his words, and returning from the tomb, they told all this to the 11 and to all the rest. Now there was Mary Magdalene, Joanna, Mary the mother of Jesus, Mary the mother of James, and other women who with them told this to the disciples. But these words seemed to them an idle tale, and they did not believe them. But Peter got up and ran to the tomb. Stooping and looking in, he saw the linen clothes by themselves, then went home amazed at what had happened. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Our next hymn this morning is "Surely the Presence of the Lord" at number 328 in your journal. Belief and unbelief, open-mindedness and closed-mindedness. These are the themes that are highlighted in this Easter gospel passage this morning, where four women who had been following Jesus throughout the entirety of his ministry, Mary Magdalene, Joanna, Mary, the mother of James, and one more woman who is unnamed in the scripture passage, go to the tomb where Jesus had been laid to lay spices along his tomb, as was the burial custom back then, to offset the smell of a decomposing body. They are shocked to see, though, that the massive tomb enclosing the stone enclosing the tomb is rolled aside, and the only thing left are the linen cloths that Jesus was wearing when he was placed in the tomb. An angel suddenly appeared to abate their confusion. "Why do you look for the living among the dead? He has risen, just like he told you he would." The women are astonished and convicted. They know in their hearts that this is true. And so they run to tell Jesus' closest friends, the disciples. But the passage reads, these words seem to them an idle tale, and they do not believe them. Those silly women, with their fantastical hopes and stories. Peter's the only one among them who gives them any sort of credit and runs to the tomb to see for himself. Peter, ironically, the disciple known for saying the most impulsive and foolish things and acting even more so. Peter, the disciple who denied Jesus 3 times on the day that he was killed. Peter is the one who feels the flicker in his heart that what these women might be saying is true. All of the characters in this gospel passage are those who love Jesus, who were most intimate with him, who shared meals with him, who followed him throughout his ministry, who heard every single one of his teachings and saw him perform miracles and heard time and time again him telling them that he was going to die and then rise again. Yet these closest friends, their responses are not the same. They're not uniform. They are varied and span the spectrum from instant belief to instant unbelief to instant curiosity. I hope this gives us all comfort here in this room that there's no right way to be a follower of Jesus. And the varied responses of these characters, I'm sure, accurately map on to the varied beliefs in this room. Some of us believe wholeheartedly in the resurrection. Some of us don't. Some of us think that he lived a good enough life and that is good enough for our Christian faith. Some of us think that the resurrection was metaphorical, and others of us think that it was merely spiritual. I myself have adopted each of these ideas at various points in my own spiritual journey. Whatever your take on the resurrection might be, however, there is an invitation in this passage to look beyond what you see with your eyes and your mind. And there is an invitation in this passage to break out of your limiting beliefs and begin to see with the eyes of your heart. During the European Enlightenment of the 17th and 18th centuries, the use of reason and empirical evidence became the pinnacle of knowledge. The only way we know for sure, they taught, and many believed at the time, is if it can be proven with empirical science. This way of approaching knowledge carried on and is still very prominent today. Is it true? Prove it to me. But this was not always the case. During the medieval era, with St. Thomas Aquinas as the most influential thinker of that era, the pinnacle of knowledge was not reason or science. The pinnacle of knowledge was love. And they believed that you saw clearly if you had love for the object of your study. A great example of this that we see today is a love of grandparents for their kids. Isn't it so true that grandparents tend to see more clearly their grandchildren than the own parents do for their kids? Now, why is that the case? Because a grandparent's love for their grandchildren is much more pure and generous and doesn't make them subscribe to what they need to be and who they need to be to grow up as and how they need to act. Their love tends to be more spacious, letting their grandkids grow into the most authentic version of themselves. And perhaps this is why the people closest to Jesus, the disciples with the highest expectations of what Jesus is supposed to be and do for them, are very attached to this idea of who Jesus needs to be as the most powerful leader of all. And they felt betrayed by the humiliating way that he ended his life. They were thinking with their reason, with their eyes, with their attached ideas, and not with their hearts. Some of us may have had the experience of making decisions that overrided our reason and logic because there was something inside our hearts that saw differently. Maybe you bought a house that everybody else thought was garbage, but you saw a possibility because you were seeing with the eyes of your heart. Maybe you married somebody that everybody else thought was absolutely wrong for you, but you knew in your heart that that person was right for you. And some of us have had the opposite experience where we followed our reason instead of our hearts because the nudging of our hearts just seemed way too risky. And then we realized soon after that we had made a big mistake. Our hearts see more clearly than our minds or our eyes. Not to say that we shouldn't use them all in conjunction with one another. They are all gifts from God to live the most abundant life. As Jesus said to the lawyer who asked him how to receive eternal life, and Jesus responded, "Love the Lord with all your heart, with all your soul, and all your mind." As my professors in seminary would tell us repeatedly, that faith in things unseen and intellect must always work together, not divorced from each other, when we're studying the Bible and learning about God. Nancy so aptly pointed out in our Bible study this past week that there's so much to despair over in this world today if we just see with our eyes and our minds. Isn't that true? There's so much to despair over in the world today when we just see with our eyes and our minds. The pandemic, which we assume would only last a couple weeks, when it first started, seems to be never ending, with a new variant coming out every few months. There is not another war breaking out across the globe where thousands and thousands upon thousands of Ukrainians and Russians are dying because of bombs or attacks or lack of access to food and water. This past week, we learned of yet another bombing in the New York City subway. And then there are also some devastating situations, I'm sure, in many of our personal lives. If we see with our eyes and our minds alone, it is indeed cause for much despair. But as Nancy also shared, if we are brave enough to have faith and to use the eyes of our hearts, we can see a completely different story. If we're brave enough to open the eyes of our hearts, we can see a different story. And so I want to ask you, how can you change your old story to a gold story? How can the seemingly lifeless and hopeless aspects of your life be resurrected? So instead of the old story, nothing good ever comes to me, I never get the job that I want, the romantic partner I want, the whatever else I want, the gold story is, no, so many good things come to me every single day. My health, food, my ability to dream and pursue things, the things that I want. These are all good things. Instead of, I'm frail and weak and I can't do the things I used to do, the gold story is, I'm older now and I have a larger well of wisdom to draw from. Thanks be to God, I can't do the physical things I used to do, but I can do things that fill humans with most joy, which is connecting with others, connecting with God, connecting with nature. Instead of, I don't have the kind of money that I need to live the life that I want, the gold story is, I can pursue happiness with any kind of money. I don't have to have a certain amount of money to have the joy that God wants me to have. And instead of, I really screwed up, I made a really large mistake, the gold story is, we all make mistakes. That's a part of life. That's how we learn. God is infinitely forgiving and merciful and gives us countless chances to right our wrongs. So I ask you once again, how can you change your old story to a gold story? How can the seemingly lifeless and hopeless aspects of your life be resurrected? Also in our Bible study group, we are talking about how church attendance has been on the decline for decades now, and how fewer and fewer people in this world identify as Christians. Why is this the case, we wondered? Is it because we're weird? We are weird, let's own it. We worship a dead man who came back to life, who says he came back to life 2,000 years ago. We say that he's expressed through bread and juice that we consume, and we believe that when we consume that bread and juice, we become like him. We study an ancient book that is poetic, but very confusing and boring, and it says things like, thou shall not eat shellfish, and thou shall not cut your hair. I dress in a shapeless robe that makes me look like a mage from Aladdin. And a lot of my friends don't know what this is and why I wear it. Is it a scarf? Do I wear it because I'm cold? Or as Linda pointed out, is church decline due to the fact that Christians get a bad rap? We're responsible for so many historical genocides and racism and homophobia and closed-mindedness. Oh, I could go on. But what if we Christians were known for something different? I don't mind being weird, by the way. But what if Christians could be known for something different than all of this? For being known as people who tell a story of hope when all seems bleak. For being people who see with the eyes of our hearts, who don't buy into the messages all around us based on scientific evidence and reason. If we sat by our physically ailing family members and brought them food and comfort and a prayer asking for God's healing, and then actually being their healing by sharing stories of fun memories with them. What if we gave life to our friend who is desperately trying to work and looking for work, but unsuccessful, and told her that there is in fact something out there for her that utilizes her exact set of gifts, but that there is divine timing that she needs to trust, and that she needs to trust and believe in her abilities. She needs to see herself the way we see her. And instead of complaining about people who always seem to be bothering us, to be tender and gentle with them instead, following Jesus' command to love one another the way we would like to be treated. What if we were known for people sharing resurrection stories rather than lifeless, discouraging, cynical stories? There's just too much of those. I myself am not always successful at this, but I knew I had done something right when one of my good friends, who's not a Christian and not a churchgoer, said to me, "Gosh, my husband and I have been really depressed these days about the state of the world. Maybe we should go back to church to get a different perspective." If any of what she said was based on anything I had done or said to her to reflect my faith, then I knew that I was accurately reflecting my faith to the people around me. Yes, we come to church to get a different perspective. That is why we do all the weird things that we do. That is why we come to this place to sing songs and hear stories, to get a new perspective, a resurrection story, a totally different one than the one the rest of the world promotes. The gospel passage for this morning reveals that the woman came at dawn to lay spices upon the tomb. And as the rays of the sun spread across the dark sky, we too are called to be those rays of light, casting a different light to this dark world. At the very end of our Bible study this past week, when we studied this very passage, I asked the group, do you hear anything from the Spirit inviting you into action? And both Marjorie and I heard at the same time, independently of one another, the Spirit say, be the light. Be the light. Be the light for this world. Be my light for this world. Thanks be to God. Amen. In the service when we get to share our joys and concerns. And though our family feeling has expanded for today, we're still going to carry on this tradition because that is what we do here. We share our joys so we don't have to carry it alone, and we share our burdens so we don't have to carry that burden alone. So now you are invited to share any joys or concerns that you would like for us to lift up together in prayer as a community. Yes, go ahead, Jeff.
Yesterday, Carol and I celebrated our 45th wedding anniversary.
Welcome. We're so glad you're here this morning. And congratulations, Jeff and Carol.
I'm so blessed. I have three joys today. Christ is risen.
Amen.
And he's surely in this place.
Amen.
We had a fantastic breakfast, and I'd like to say thank you to the ladies and the men who helped. It was fantastic. Really. And what a beautiful weather.
Yes.
I agree with that.
Yes.
My second joy, we rehearsed before, after the breakfast, and I'm getting myself ready in the pew to sing. With all my heart. I looked up and I saw my great friend Hildy, who's visiting this church today. Mind you, she is a Methodist and she worships at another place. But just back of one, on Monday service, Pastor, I'd like to congratulate you. That's the first time in my life I attended a Monday service. I attended Good Friday service. When my mother would hide the goodies in her purse because we were there for 3 hours. Yeah, on a Good Friday, and the islands is 3 hours, not one. And so we were starving as kids. She had a little goodie in her bag for us. So when it's finished, she hands us her little package. God bless her. The next thing I'd like to say, so my friend who came with me to service, Monday service, she took the time to call me and to say, June, thank you so much for inviting me to church last night. It was so refreshing. I cleaned up my soul. That's my one friend. I looked up this morning and I saw my friend in the middle of the church. We worshiped together at the other United Methodist when her kids were tiny. Now her kids are adults and they have their own children. But we taught them in the right way. And I think they're all at church today, Easter Sunday.
Here today?
Not here.
Okay, but they are at church somewhere. Thanks be to God.
They live in Georgia, yes. That's number two. My number, so Hildy, welcome. The church welcomes you.
Oh, Hildy is here this morning.
Hildy is here.
Oh, welcome! Yay!
And so my other friend from on the service wants to thank you. It was a refreshing service. For those people who were here on Thursday, I think you most likely feel the same way I do. My third joy, I'll be done soon. My third joy is the answer was yes. Okay, we received an invitation for Easter dinner about 5 weeks ago. But everyone knows my husband has not been well. And so I don't force him to do things. I let him wander through his thoughts and so. Anyway, my friend texts me, I didn't see your name on the list, Julie. Are you coming to Easter dinner? I said to Albert, look, just taking the time to ask me this question. I don't want to tell you you have to go to Easter dinner, okay? I'm not like that. But if you'd like to go, let me know so you could make preparations. Put at least two more. And he said, oh no, I don't think I can make it. I said, okay, let me respond to her, we are not coming to Easter dinner. And since you're not going, I'm not going either. He says, oh no, oh no, oh no, Jim, we have to go to Easter dinner. I said, well, you just said you're not going. So I said, I'm asking you the last time, would you like to go to Easter dinner? He said, oh yes, so I cannot let you drive that way by yourself. It's almost 2 hours to Simi Valley from here. And so we're going to Simi Valley for Easter dinner. He said, yes. Oh, you'll be a joy. You'll be a joy. Oh, good, thank you. Okay, me too. Because I love people. I love to be around people. And so he's making his preparation. So I don't have to drive that distance by myself. Okay? And so I thank God today that he has placed people around us to boost us, boost our spirits. It's not just the booster shot we rely on. To have a life, it's the people around us. And I thank you, Pastor, and welcome.
Thank you. Thank you for sharing all of those wonderful, wonderful news. And yes, Methodists like 1 hour services. Any other joys and concerns? Yes, go ahead, Marilyn.
Yes, I'm having some breathing issues, so I'm doing some testing and medication. So.
Thank you for sharing that. Yeah. Yes. Oh, go ahead.
Hildy.
Josie.
Hildy.
Hildy.
Hildy. Yes, I'm the again visitor. I actually sang in the choir for a while, many years ago, and I want to say that every time I come here, I feel so welcome. I feel as if I've been coming here for years, but in fact, I've not been once in a while, and I'm always very happy to be here among the students. So there's no exception.
Thank welcome. You. Thank you. And no matter where you go to church elsewhere, you're always going to find a home here. And Janelle, I saw you raise your hand. Thank you. Yes, Nancy, and then Amy.
I have several joys today. My daughter and her husband, Colette and John, and their children are here today.
Oh, where are they?
The grandsons are in Sunday school. So it's so good to have them. As you know, Paul was here last week. And today is one of Paul's friends is here. Judy and Dave and Susie are here, and they're here.
Can you guys raise your hands?
They're friends of Paul's and ours, and we see them all the time at the Walnut concerts in the summertime. So good to see them here today.
How lovely. Thank you for joining us this morning. And then Amy, yes. In this church?
Yeah, 2 years ago,
to get married here, we can talk about pricing. Just kidding, you can get married wherever you want. As long as Amy approves. I also have a joy. My dad is here, and my mom, and my brother, and sister-in-law. And his birthday was yesterday. We like to say forever 40. Any other joys or concerns? And some concerns may be too personal and vulnerable to share, and that's okay. We'll have a time to express that to God in the silence of our prayers. Let us now pray together. Dear God, we thank you for gathering all of us from around this city, this region, and some of us are visiting even across the country. We have gathered in this place to celebrate what you have done for us, is come back to life, to show us that your love for us is so powerful and mysterious that we cannot understand it. And yet we can feel it and see it with our eyes all the time. And let us know that love deeply every day, especially when things seem bleak in the world and in our own personal lives. For us to hear your voice say to us that you are here for us, that you love us, that you are walking with us. And with this confidence, we now lift up to you these prayers that have come before the community. We unite our hearts to lift these hopes and these concerns up to you, knowing that no prayer is too big and no prayer is too menial for you. We are grateful for Jeff and Carol's long marriage, for blessing them with each other. We are grateful for their family gathering together again at this church that has been so important to them. We thank you for June and all of the ways that you connected with her during Holy Week and her friends, for the way that you even connected with her husband and are allowing that air celebration to continue all day for them. We are grateful for her friend, Hilly, who is here with us today, worshiping with us and feeling a part of the family that we know that we are. We are grateful for Nancy and her leadership among us and the attendance of her family and her friends here. And of course, we're also grateful for other family members who are here, for Amy's children, Andrew and JJ, and their partners. And we are grateful for all of the birthdays that are being celebrated in this room. We also lift up to you those who are sick and weak and need your guidance and help. For Albert, for Marilyn, who is concerned about her breathing and wants to know more and get some more guidance. We pray for Bob, Carol's brother, whom we've been praying for, and that you, O God, are sending him angels to surround him with comfort and peace and joy during what we sense are his last days. We pray continuously for the war going on thousands of miles away from us, and yet we read news of it every day. And now at this time, let us lift up any other prayers that are nudging our hearts, that have burdening us. Prayers of gratitude or prayers of concern, let us lift them out now in the silence of our hearts, knowing that God is listening with generous ears. with all of these prayers that we have named before you, O God, open the blazing eyes of our hearts so that we may see a very different story than the one that everybody else sees around us. And by that new perspective, may people know that we are people of resurrection. And together we pray the prayer that Jesus himself taught us, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever.
Thank you.
crowned with many crowns, number 327 in your traditional hymnal. Generously given to us, and let us see what God, the miracles God can do with our small contributions. Since we resumed in-person worship, we've not passed the offering plate, yet you are still invited to give to strengthen to this congregation so that we may be a light to everybody who steps into this congregation. And so the offering plate is near the sanctuary doors, or you can also give online or through mail. Now may we go out from this place with the love of the cross, the power of the resurrection, and the presence of the living Lord, now and forever. Amen.